Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
This November, the Nassau Guardian is celebrating 180 years. And we want to thank you, our loyal readers, for helping to make this one of the oldest newspapers in the region. We want you to be a part of our Vision Challenge giveaway promotion beginning October 28th through November 22nd. All you need to do is find the hidden Nassau Guardian 180 years logo printed every day in the Nassau Guardian newspaper, and you could win prize money. Just purchase your daily Nassau Guardian newspaper every day beginning Monday, October 28th. Find the 180th Nassau Guardian logo, cut out the page, mark the spot, write your name and phone number on that clipping, drop off your entries at our offices on Carter Street in Oaksfield, and every Friday, November 1st, November 8th, November 15th, and November 22nd, one drawing will take place. It's that simple.
American woman, stay away from me. American woman, mama, let me be.
Good yawning this morning, and welcome back to Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, your station for fresh news, smart talk all day. It's Tuesday, the 5th of October, 2024, and you are on the clock with Erin Greene, and the entire United States of America is on the clock because today is election day. Have a full conversation today. Let's start it off with this. I aim to explain the relationship between the Bahamas and the United States of America today in two songs by a man who may be best suited to tell us, to reflect the nature of the relationship between the Bahamas and the United States of America. Our very own, their very own, Lenny Kravitz. So we started with the song American Woman, and I want you all to wait to hear what the second song is. We're talking U.S. elections today. Before there, we get there, I have a little bit of housekeeping to do. And, you know, when I opened up the papers this morning, I was like, oh boy, again, the tension, right, between the Bahamas and the U.S. This United States election is very important to a territory, a jurisdiction, a sovereign nation like the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. But can it ever be more important than the stories emanating from the Commonwealth of the Bahamas itself? So here are the questions I am putting on the table for that conversation, and then we're going to get back around to it. First question, who will win? Second question, do you know who all the candidates are? Third question, who would you vote for if you could? Who are you voting for because you can? Fourth question, what's the most outrageous thing that Trump has said or done? Subpart to that question, does Trump's hyperbolic language distort the truth in some of his statements? Number five, pros and cons of a Harris-Waltz presidency, and another sub-question, does Harris's stance on the Netanyahu Hamas Palestine genocide make her, quote, as bad as Trump, close quotes? Those are the conversation, those are the questions for the conversation. But let's get the show started. I have to start by saying happy cake and ice cream day to the one Mr. Eric Sawyer III. I want to say it must have been a wonderful weekend. 49ers came off of a win the week before, roll into bye week for a little rest. So at least you didn't have to see them lose for your big day. Get a big week coming up for the 49ers, but of course a big week for Mr. Eric Sawyer III. Happy birthday. And if we talk in Eric Sawyer III, then you know we talk in jokes and comedy. I've got some news for you. The Black Box at the Dundas is preparing a stage for you. Join us at the Black Box for our very first open mic night fundraiser. Whether you're a singer, poet, musician, or actor, we want to see you shine on stage. Bring your friends along to share and connect with fellow creatives in a welcoming space as we support local artists. Continue to follow the Black Box page for more exciting news about this new upcoming evening venue. And for those who are comedians, improv actors, comics, there's a practice tonight at the Dundas Black Box at 7:30. Please come out and attend. It's time to warm up the chops and let's get the jokes going. Okay, the rest of our news is a bit more, I wouldn't say somber, but it is what's in the news. So yesterday, a texter asked me to respond to or talk about an incident that I had not read fully at that time. It's in today's Guardian. Employee stabbed at Bahama. A man who stabbed a woman at Bahama yesterday morning was caught and arrested after he tried to flee the scene, officials said. Police said the woman, 25, an employee of the resort, was stabbed by a 34-year-old man who was known to her around 8 a.m. As he tried to flee, the man was caught and subdued until police arrived. Police said the woman, who had several stab wounds, was taken to hospital and was listed in serious condition. Bahama Senior Vice President Robert Sandy Sands confirmed that an incident did happen at the resort and extended his sympathies to the victim. Quick switch of headlines. I want to go into the third page of The Guardian. I'm calling this little section A Tale of Two Cases of Rape. Businessman acquitted of rape of teen. A businessman was on Monday acquitted of raping a 13-year-old in his store following a trial before Justice Archer Minnis. Prosecutors say Sean Pindling sexually assaulted the schoolgirl at Bain Tech, an appliance repair shop on Blue Hill Road, on September 20th, 2019. According to the prosecution's case, Pindling and the alleged victim's mother once had an intimate relationship, but he remained friends with the family. The alleged victim said she would visit Pindling after school and he'd give her between $10 and $20 for lunch. On the day in question, the teen claimed that Pindling propositioned her when she went to see him. The teen said despite turning Pindling down, he took her to the back of the shop, pushed her on the ground, and raped her. After he was done, the teen said Pindling gave her $50. She said she went to a store and bought two packs of crackers and went home. The accuser said that she saw blood in her underwear and assumed that her menstrual cycle had started, but that wasn't the case. When she arrived home around 3:45 p.m., her mother asked her why the back of her shirt was dirty. The now 18-year-old said that she told her mother that someone pushed her, but her mother didn't believe her and said that it looked like she was lying on the ground because the back of her shirt was dirty. After her mother's repeated questioning, the girl told her mother that Pindling raped her. She said that her mother reported the matter to the police and she was taken to the hospital. The examining physician said the teen had a laceration to her genitals and her hymen was not intact. She also saw what she believed to be semen. Pindling denied the allegation when police held a confrontation between him and the accuser. At the trial, Pindling exercised his right to remain silent and call no witnesses in his defense. Pindling's lawyer, Donna Major, pointed out that there wasn't any forensic evidence. After 2 hours of deliberations, the jury of 7 women and 2 men returned a verdict of not guilty by a vote of 6-3. Terry Archer and Betty Wilson were the prosecutors. I wanted to read that story into the record. I want to just reiterate this part before we transition to the next story. Pindling denied the allegation when police held a confrontation between him and the accuser. What exactly does that mean? When I go and I look at police procedures, how would that process be described? Right? Pindling denied the allegation when police held a confrontation between him and the accuser. Now, I have been told, right, this is like anecdotal, to go before a court. The judge would tell me, Erin, Greene, that's hearsay, right? But I've been told that it is a regular occurrence for victims of sexual violence to be made to face their accuser in an interview-style intervention, or process. I'm very interested to know why the reporter used the language. Pindling denied the allegation when police held a confrontation between him and his accuser. Is a victim, an accuser, supposed to face the accused before the court process begins? And what if the accuser is a minor and the accused is an adult? Are lawyers present? Does the accuser have a lawyer present when this process that is in this article defined or described as a confrontation, is there a lawyer present for the accuser? So we could use that language, the accuser. Because maybe the word victim is loaded, right? Maybe. Producer, let's go to the phone line as I transition to the second story. Good morning, caller.
A godly day to this doc in a waste along with you, Erin.
Good morning, morning.
Erin, I'm listening to you, right?
Yes, sir.
A couple of things. The teachers need to be educating our children. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Come on, those teachers joking, man. Let me show you something. That young lady should have took the $50 to the police. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And something else I wanted to say. But if she had, you know, if she had the wisdom to just, you know,
mm-hmm.
because she was in a compromising position.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah. How do we how do we prepare our young people to navigate the adult world? Because that's an adult situation if it is true that she was forced into.
Our teachers are not doing just to our Bahamian children.
Brayman, let me see if I could rephrase it. Maybe the curricula has to be changed that enables the teachers to include this type of education in their daily school practice, right?
Yes.
Because if we are teaching abstinence only, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where is the space to say, now look here, young people. Y'all are sexual beings. You're going to have sexual feelings. You're going to be aroused and at some point by anything. The wind will arouse you. A deep voice will arouse you. A soft, caressing voice will arouse you, young men. That everything around you at this age will arouse you. And that is a natural part of life. But your job now is to practice that self-discipline and that self-control that keeps you safe.
You know, our children need to be taught how to travel the street, travel among people,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Absolutely.
The advantage of being taken.
Yep, they're being taken advantage of.
Yes.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you, Brayman.
Thank you.
We stopped teaching them how to walk the road. I came across a group of students. They were partially on a sidewalk, partially in the road. The sidewalk was large enough to accommodate all of them, but the road was not large enough to accommodate two lanes of cars and two young people walking in the road side by side. Young people are taking the most dangerous risks. I was traveling in Johnson Road, and a young lady, without looking back, right, because she was walking with traffic, she had 10 feet of verge to walk in safely. She decided to just step into the road without looking back to see where the cars were. I had to come to a complete stop. And the cars behind me were upset that I didn't drive past. But a couple of by them, they cool by them, you know, on the side of the road was like, yeah, miss, we don't know what she's dealing with. And see, that's important, right? Because witnesses, bystanders, observers, they denote how callously we engage pedestrians, even if the pedestrian is at fault. Even if the pedestrian is the idiot in the road. it's still our duty as the drivers, the operators of motor vehicles, to drive in a way that prepares us for the eventuality or the possibility that an idiot pedestrian may cross our path. Okay, let's get to the second story quickly. In today's Tribune, young man sentenced to 10 years for unlawful sex with 13-year-old girl. A 27-year-old man has been sentenced to 10 years behind bars after pleading guilty to unlawful sexual intercourse with a 13-year-old girl. Quincy Edgecombe, who was 25 at the time of the offense, gave the girl his cell number in August 2022, claiming he initially met her on Instagram. On August 14, 2022, he collected the girl in a black Paso vehicle from her grandmother's residence and took her to a friend's residence in Elizabeth Estates, where they engaged in sexual intercourse in the bedroom. On August 16th this year, Edgecombe pleaded guilty to one count of unlawful sexual intercourse. It is a crime for anyone to have sexual intercourse with a person under 14, whether the person consents or not, and those convicted face up to life in prison with a minimum of 7 years for a first offense and 14 years for any further offenses. Full stop. I also want to add, it is also a crime for anyone to have sexual intercourse with a person under 16, but the penalties are different. So I just wanted to read those into the record. A tale of two cases of rape. The other headlines, shelter residents called for leniency after being asked to leave. This is also another, I think, very interesting and important conversation, because this is a conversation about needs and expectations. This is a quick point I want to make before I transition to U.S. election talk. I saw word on social media that individuals are organizing a demonstration. That's what they're going to call it. They may have used the word protest, but they want to organize a demonstration in support of the individuals being asked to leave the shelter. And I want to say this, that if you have the capacity to organize resources and people for a demonstration or a protest, then understand the power that you have at your hands, the capacity that you actually have. First off, let's acknowledge the limitations of the state's resources, even if it's a limitation of political will, the limitations of state resources. We understand that while a group of people may be requesting, begging for more time, there's a group of people who are desperately requesting some time, right? And so there's a balance that the government has to determine how best to expend its resources. If you have the capacity to organize a protest or a demonstration, you also have the capacity to organize housing for the people you are advocating for. If you have the capacity to organize a protest or a demonstration, then you have the capacity to begin organizing solutions and resolutions for people in housing crises. Let us take that same energy and focus it on getting people into homes. And at the same time, you take a small portion of your resources to focus on an advocacy campaign that lobbies for the government to create real, substantive housing solutions for the vulnerable, for the unemployed, for the underemployed, for victims of violence, for people transitioning from the family islands. Because you could do it. So I just wanted to make that point. Last headline, government hosting energy summit this week. It is Tuesday. It is Tuesday. The article reads, Minister of Energy and Transport Joe Beth Kobe Davis said a two-day energy summit will be held this week on New Providence to engage partners and the public as it relates to plans for reform of the energy sector in the Bahamas. The summit, which is being hosted by the ministry, will take place at Bahama Convention Center, will begin on Thursday under the theme, quote, accelerating the Bahamas' energy transition through innovation and strategic partnerships, close quotes. It's Tuesday. Why are you just telling us about this today and the things start on Thursday? How do we organize our resources to make ourselves available to participate fully in what is perhaps one of the most important government public engagement activities of the decade? Let's go to the phone line. Good morning, caller.
Yes, how you doing, Ms. Greene?
I'm good, thank you.
Yeah, you prompted me to call us concerning your request for those individuals to organize themselves. Just let me say that for the last two decades, the government of the Bahamas has been trying to develop a social safety net.
Mm-hmm.
And they have the information that is necessary, and it's not in the public domain. The information lies within NIB, it lies within education, it lies in the Ministry of Labor, and various different Ministry of Finance, various different entities.
Mm-hmm.
And those information has not been brought forward. Now, I can, and Dave, you know, the program is called Now Promise. It is work from the IDB, the IMF, and other individuals concerning the growing economic disparity in the Bahamas. If you go back, which brings you right to that survey that we talked about yesterday, the $10,000 middle class. Let me first let individuals know, because they have it a totally out of context. If you don't meet that $10,000 a month, that ain't about you, okay? When people found out that who thought they were in the middle class came to realize that they are not. And if you examine the GDP and the 67% of the average people by dividing the GDP by the total number of actual workforce versus the whole population, and then times it by 0.67%, you'll come up with the 10,000. But you'll also find that the salaries run between $10,000 a month and $45,000 a month. So if you're in the middle class, you're talking with you. So that means that we have a larger working class or an enlarging underclass than we may have estimated. And when you move into the increase of that underclass is when you begin to see the poverty increase. And if you look at going back to 2014, where it was at 13%, and you could only assume it's increased exponentially this time, meaning that we absolutely positively need a social safety net. And so these individuals are suffering from housing desert.
Mm-hmm.
And there has been no strategy with the government house. And if you use that very same study, Ms. Greene, and you need 1% of a house value for rent. So if you have a $300,000 house, you need $3,000 a month. If you need a $200,000 house, you need $2,000 a month to be able to cover the cost of owning that, whether you're the landlord or the renter, maybe you have to pay a little more.
Mm-hmm.
The question is, where is the strategies, the policies, the positions, the creative financing, whatever it is, to fill this vacancy? If you look at what the minister said, and because the information is right in the front of us. The previous minister gave us 30,000-40,000 deficiencies. We're supposed to be building 4,000 houses a year. We're only building 1,600. The new minister come back and say, we are starting out at a 12,000 housing deficit. The question then becomes, you're creating an environment, but if they really have a solution, a social safety net, it should be available to everyone, more so the NGOs, et cetera, so that we all can have buy-in and understand where we are. The greatest mistake, I'm in and saying that, wind it up and saying this, you cannot manage what you cannot measure, but you cannot measure what you refuse to acknowledge.
Mm-hmm.
We are in an economic crisis within our country, and the best way to not be able to discuss it is to keep the information out of the public domain, so that you don't have to be able to confront it, because when you confront, there's an expectation that you as the leadership class would have a solution that you have to present.
Absolutely.
And I think it's incumbent upon us now to realize that survey, what is happening at social services, and what we may see within our community, and what has been said by the individuals that are giving hints of everything, that we have to have a conversation of where we are and where we want to be. What's now, what's new, and what's next.
Thank you so much. Thank you, C. Allen. Call, I come into you right now. What the question I want to put on the table after your contribution, C. Allen, is, am I not in the middle class because I ain't making enough money, or I'm not in the middle class because my country does not have the institutions and systems that middle class people plug into with their money. Good morning, caller. Good morning, caller. I missed you. Caller, please call back. The numbers to call, 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259, 242-300-5720. Toll free for Family Island residents. And the text line, powered by BTC, is 422-GR96. That's 422-4796. Let's go to the phone line. Good morning, caller.
Pardon me, let me turn on the radio, please. Erin, what I want to ask you, right? Hello?
Yes, I'm here.
Wonderful. Who are asking for partnership, and what type of partnership? I missed that.
With which specific subject? The shelters? The residents in the shelters?
Oh, I missed that,
That's what I was talking about, Bremen. The people who are demonstrating in support of the people who are being asked to leave the shelter because their time is up.
Okay.
I'm saying that they have the capacity, right, to build the partnerships necessary to find housing or housing solutions for many of the people they're advocating for.
Yeah, government's supposed to do that.
Not government. Government is already doing it, but its resources are limited for whatever reason, right? Whether it's a policy reason or it's a fiscal reason, the resources available are limited. And so I think a better use of the energy and effort by those who are organizing protests are to organize resources.
Let me ask you something. Why is it that government are not in partnership with the other party?
Because the other parties are just forming. They are loose organizations of concerned people. And what they have to do to build their capacity is form formal organizations, register under the Nonprofit Organization Act, so as to increase their opportunity for funding and grants and resources. Also, to be able to enter a formal space where government is required to speak to them as local stakeholders in civil society. And then with this legitimacy of a formally registered and organized group, they can then seek funding and support from the business sector and the professional sectors in the country.
Let me ask you something.
Yes, sir.
Sorry for cutting you. Knowing that this situation is a need,
yes,
right?
Freeman. Mm-hmm.
The other party, right?
Yeah.
Are not able to satisfy or to help satisfy the need at present.
Right.
Why is it that the government don't, take the bull by the horn and assist its people?
Well, that's another question, an absolutely valid question, right? And it's what Cialin spoke to. First, the government has to acknowledge that there's a housing crisis. But when they acknowledge there's a housing crisis, what is inherent is that they are responsible for creating an environment where people can solve their individual housing crises. But the solution to individual crises sometimes rests in a larger collective solution, which is where the government comes in.
Knowing that government has to acknowledge, are those people legal? That government doesn't know.
Okay, so here we go. Let's address that. We have various categories of people, right? We will have Bahamians. We will have Bahamians that have already initiated a legal process to have their citizenship reflect their genealogy, right? Like, I'm a Bahamian, I born to a Bahamian, or I was born here and I fit within the legal criteria for citizenship, right?
I got you. So
there's two different categories: Bahamians in waiting. Then you have the undocumented migrant, right? Three categories of people. The government
negligent,
the government has
negligent, and who's that?
Hold on. The government has different obligations to different categories of people when it comes to housing, right? If an undocumented person is detained in the Bahamas, the government has an obligation to provide safe and adequate housing until their status is processed, whether they claim asylum or for refugee status, or they're just being processed to be returned home. The government still has an obligation to ensure that the housing that they are accommodated in is safe and is hygienic, right? If it is Bahamian in waiting, once it has been determined that they have a right to be here, right? Then the government has an obligation to ensure that if they find themselves living in unsavory conditions, that there are options available that they can be referred to, even if the government doesn't manage those housing options themselves. If it is a Bahamian, there's no question of status, right? The government has an obligation to primarily ensure that people can access housing. That doesn't mean that the government has to provide the housing, but the government needs to ensure that there's housing that matches the wages, that what people get paid, that there's housing that matches what they get paid, right? That's the obligation, even if they're not required to provide the housing themselves. But the government should, in recognizing that there are people here who are vulnerable. For example, a person born with either intellectual challenges or severe physical difficulties or disabilities, whose parents or guardians have passed away, whose next of kin have passed away. Now you have an adult who has identifiable and articulable needs with no guardian to depend on. The state is obligated to provide housing and care for those individuals.
Let me ask you something. Mm-hmm. What happened to our social work people? What are they doing to assist those people that are in need?
They are doing, but it appears as if they are severely constrained by the limitation of resources made available to them. But Bremen, I want transition now. I got another caller on the line, but no, thank you very much for a very insightful line of interrogation. Let's go to the call and then the text, and then we can play that next song, producer. Good morning, caller.
Yes, just give me 2 minutes, okay?
Mm-hmm.
The four type of the six type of housing that's needed in the Bahamas is called social housing, low cost housing, affordable housing, attainable housing, and then it goes into mid-luxury, luxury, and above. So those four lower ones is what you need. But what happens is, the question you ask is, according to the GDP, if you extrapolate from the $16 billion, the $225,000 workforce, every single person in the workforce is making $72,000. And so, but when you know that everybody's not equal, so when you look at the workforce, it means that according to that $72,000 times 0.67, that's the median for the middle class. So the $10,000 as an individual or couple is correct. The problem is that you can't change that figure. The question has to be asked, where is the money? Now, it brings us back to, I think it was your Mondays or whatever paper, the newspaper that was asked on Thursday of last week, where Teresa Turner Jones made the statement concerning the workforce. The question is, where have we provided the skill set training and transition to have individuals earn that income they talk about? You remember the government said about the livable wage?
Mm-hmm.
So you want to give a livable wage, but you must have productivity that comes from those individuals that matches that livable wage. And so we talk about these things in absence of the cohesive harmony that must exist to achieve these goals that we have. And that's the problem, is we allow our politicians to give us wordsmiths, to become wordsmiths and give us just statements and no follow-up on it. Explain me how, what, whatever. The most important thing is how do we achieve this?
Give us
a written strategy.
Absolutely. What is the rationale for the policy and what is the strategy?
And the supporting data to support how you arrive at the position and we move forward. So labor and education and social services are major failures which contribute to the policing issue and the crime and everything else. Everything is interrelated in this ecosystem.
Absolutely.
So we try to treat each one as individual.
Thank you very much. Thank you, C. Allen. Producer, play the second song from us. See, this is the tension. Oh, boy, let's go to the caller dead quick. This is the tension right here. I want to talk American politics. American woman, why you won't let me be. Good morning, caller.
How you doing, Mary?
I good, thank you.
Okay. All of C. Allen, you know, said is good, but a wrench is thrown into that data.
Mm-hmm.
Into that system when you have a tingsy people. Okay?
Yeah, okay.
And the devil is in the details because this is what our politicians cater to.
I hear you.
That is what they do better than anybody else.
But I mean I would say that, you know, the relationship between the merchant class and the political class means that
it's rock solid.
Whether knowingly or unknowingly, the political class perpetuates a culture of overconsumption, especially since they are on a tax and duty derived revenue strategy right now. I would say it like that. But listen, thank you very much for your contribution. A very important point that you make in as well. I want to know, where are the economists so we could sit down and discuss these things in a myriad of ways, like in multiple different ways. Contributions have been fantastic. Producer, I want you to play the second song, right? See, because American Woman speaks to the tension just like today, because guess what? The only thing they're talking about in America today is American news. That's it, American election. And whatever else they're talking about is what impacts the election, right? And so here's this beautiful tension between us. Play the second song as we go to a break, producer, please. This is another song by Lenny Kravitz. Again, a thesis in two songs, the relationship between the Bahamas, the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, and the United States of America.
Paradise. I belong to you. Make my life complete. You make me feel so sweet.
No matter who I marry, no matter where my wife gives birth, our children will be Bahamian, like me.
If I marry a man who's not Bahamian, I have to give birth in the Bahamas, or my children won't even be Bahamian like I am.
That don't even make sense.
That's why we had the referendum in 2016.
But the people vote no.
The government can still do something about it with ordinary legislation. And it needs to develop an action plan and timeline to hold another referendum to deal with gender inequality in the Constitution.
Oh, we can make that happen.
Go to tiny.cc/nationality to support the campaign for equal nationality rights by Equality Bahamas.
Reliable and impactful printing services, look no further. Let Printmasters bring your masterpiece to life. We stand by our quality products that is second to none. Our affordable pricing and friendly, efficient staff makes Printmasters the ultimate choice for all your printing needs. We can deliver any type of printing services, from banners to booklets to business cards. You name it, we can print it.
Let Printmasters bring your masterpiece to life.
Located at the Nassau Guardian Building, telephone 302-2361.
Unequal gender nationality law is a violation of human rights and a failure of the government to meet its obligations. In 2018, the CEDAW Committee told the Bahamas to set a clear time frame for constitutional reform, to integrate the principle of gender equality into all laws, and to amend the Bahamas Nationality Act 1973 for Bahamian women and men to transmit citizenship on an equal basis. Join Equality Bahamas in demanding action now. Visit tiny.cc/nationality for more.
Love the show? Want to give your support? Become a sponsor today. Call 302-2300 for our rates and packages. That's 302-2300. Become a sponsor on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Your soul and mine are entwined. Before you I was blind, but since I've opened my eyes, and with you there's no disguise, so I could open up my mind. I always loved you from the start, but I could not figure out that I had to do it every day. So I put away the fight. Now I'm gonna live my life, giving you the most in every way. Oh, I belong to you.
Good morning and welcome back to Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. You are on the clock with Erin Greene. Like I say, a thesis in two songs, the relationship between the Bahamas and the United States of America. But even more so, those two songs, I think, reflect or represent the dichotomy of sentiment, right, in the Bahamas about the United States of America. Either you feel like, American woman, get away from me with your cultural imperialist self. It's not that I don't like, it's not that I dislike everything about you. It's like, I don't get to dislike the things I dislike about you and still like you at the same time. Am I allowed to like you and not like some parts of you at the same time? But I belong to you and you belong to me. Like that also, I mean, completely wraps up the relationship between the Bahamas and the United States of America. Well, today is, I want to say pun intended, D-Day. And here I'm going to read quickly from an article from the UK Guardian on the 3rd of November, 2024. That's Sunday. It's entitled, Everything You Need to Know About the 2024 U.S. Presidential Election. So we're going through a little briefer on the election. The 60th U.S. presidential election will decide the 47th president, widely held to be the most powerful job in the world. Not as important as the person responsible for the bread at the hospital, though. And the 50th vice president, so this will be the 60th U.S. presidential election. They will be electing the 47th president and the 50th vice president. All 435 seats in the House of Representatives are up for grabs, along with 34 of the 100 seats in the Senate, which together will decide the membership of the 119th Congress. 13 state and territorial governorships and numerous other state and local elections will take place. Voters in 41 states will consider a total of 159 ballot initiatives. 10 states, including Arizona, Colorado, and Florida, have abortion-related measures on the ballot, and Florida, North Dakota, and South Dakota are considering whether to legalize marijuana. Now, that's a big issue. Both of these issues, abortion and the legalization of cannabis, are big issues for the Commonwealth of the Bahamas or the citizens therein. And so you can see why people are paying attention. So let's go. Who are the presidential candidates? I ask you, who you voting, who you think will win? Well, here are the candidates. Kamala Harris, 60, the current vice president, won the Democratic Party's nomination after Joe Biden ended his reelection bid. She's a former senator, California attorney general, and San Francisco prosecutor, and is bidding to make history as the first woman and first woman of color to be elected in America's 248-year history. Donald Trump, 78, the Republican nominee, is making his third consecutive run for the White House. The businessman and reality TV star continues to repeat his false claim that Democrats stole the 2020 election from him. He is the first president to be impeached twice and convicted of a crime. Trump is also the oldest major party nominee in history, and this summer survived two assassination attempts. Candidate number three, did you know that there were more candidates on the ballot? Chase Oliver, 39, is the little-known candidate for the Libertarian Party. Oliver ran for a Georgia State Senate seat in 2022 and garnered 2% of the vote. The party, which prioritizes small government and individual freedoms, typically gains 3% or less of the national vote, but its members could yet prove crucial in swing states. Candidate number four, Jill Stein, 74. A physician who ran under the Greene Party in 2016 is running again in 2024. She launched a current campaign accusing Democrats of betraying their promises, quote, for working people, youth, and the climate, again and again, while Republicans don't even make such promises in the first place, close quotes. Candidate number five, the one and only, Cornel West, 71, is running as an independent candidate. The political activist, philosopher, and academic is making an effort to attract more progressive, Democratic-leaning voters. What are the main issues that will decide the White House? So the issues listed in this article are abortion. This is the first presidential election since the Supreme Court overturned Roe versus Wade, the 1973 ruling that enshrined the constitutional right to abortion. Many Republican-led states have since imposed total or near-total bans on the procedure. Harris has made reproductive rights and personal freedoms a rallying cry and backs a national law codifying access to safe abortion. Trump has struggled to find his footing on the issue, insisting that it is a state matter and belatedly ruling out a national ban. Constitutional amendments that would protect or expand abortion rights will appear on the ballot in 10 states, which Democrats hope will drive higher turnout. Again, abortion, I think, is a big issue, even for Bahamians. Many Bahamians have been able to access abortions, in some instances, life-saving, some instances, by being able to travel to the United States of America, where it was legal in most, if not all, states. And now that has changed. The next issue, democracy. Democrats have warned that Trump poses an existential threat to democratic norms, citing the 6th of January 2021 insurrection, when a mob of his supporters attempted to overturn his election defeat. A recent Washington Post Shaw School Survey of voters in seven swing states found that slightly more trust Trump to handle threats to democracy than Harris. Harris has described her opponent as a fascist who has said he would be a dictator on day one and would yield to foreign autocrats such as Vladimir Putin and Kim Jong-un. We also have the arrival or the presence of Project 2025, which have many, many people concerned about a return to a pre-democratic U.S., I guess I would call it, with calls for removing subjects from the national education curriculum like African-American education. And all kinds of things. Project 2025 and the Heritage Foundation, I think, are two reasons why people think that Trump is a threat to democracy. Another issue, the economy. One of the biggest issues on the table, immigration, also another issue, not only that is important to the Bahamas, but what the policies that the U.S. creates around immigration impact us not only as potential immigrants, right, but it impacts our immigration policy. And quite frankly, I would like to hear more about what Biden termed the lily pad project in 2022 and I would like our government to tell us more about what was discussed at the summit 2022 about the lily pad plan and the Bahamas specifically and the rest of the region generally's participation in said plan. So those are the biggest issues, I think, on the table. But if you think there are bigger issues, we are out of time. I think Guardian Radio AM is also going to be talking U.S. elections. So in that space, perhaps you will want to answer one of these questions. Who do you think will win? Do you think the other three candidates are going to have a significant showing? Who would you vote for? Who are you voting for? What's the most outrageous thing that Trump has said or done, implied, that should disqualify him from candidacy? Does Trump's hyperbolic language, does his outrageous language distort what may be truth in some of his statements? And does Harris's stance on the Netanyahu, Hamas, Palestine genocide make her, quote, as bad as Trump, close quotes? Just a couple of texts, and then producer, I want you to play the song again. Text here says, great show as usual. Bahamian so opinionated about the election in the U.S. and invest so much time in the topic. I think it's only right that the USA allow us Bahamians to vote in their elections. God bless America and God bless Walmart. Another text says, hey, Ms. Green, there's a huge crack in PI Bridge. Please tell the authorities to go check it out. And the last text, this study shows that the government is failing. Middle class don't want to send to public school here, but in other countries they do. In other countries, public transport is the order of the day. Has our government forced this issue? Or better yet, has the government ensured the infrastructure necessary for people to realize the middle class dream? I think that's a question that we all should demand answers to. There's more talk. God bless America. Safe elections. No matter the outcome. Most important thing, that they have safe elections with no violence. Let's pray for that. You guys stay tuned. Guardian Radio AM with C.A. Newry is up next.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.